Hello, Don.
Hey, D-Man.
Well, thank you for joining us on another episode of Can You Be a Gay Christian? Don, why don't you introduce yourself, man?
So, my name is Donnie Madden, and I'm from Northern California originally, a small town called Ukiah. I was born and raised there. And when I was 23, I went to Tulsa, Oklahoma, and went to RawBrahs University and started studying theology and began doing foreign mission trips short term. And after I graduated, I went to work for a nonprofit and a church there in Tulsa as an administrator. And while I was there, I was licensed and ordained. And I decided that I was going to come out as a gay man, and so I stepped down from my position at the church. I tried to leave quietly and not cause any kind of scandal or put any reproach on the pastors that I was serving under or the church or the name of Christ, because I saw a lot of scandal when people were caught in a situation that was unethical. And so, not that I was doing anything wrong, but I just felt like if I decided I wanted to tell my truth and not cause any kind of conflict or any pain to the people who I grew to love and to surround myself with. So that's my Christian background.
Now, you said you tried to leave quietly. Were you successful in doing that? Like, were you able to leave the church and without causing too much conflict? Or
I don't think there was any conflict. There was just one-on-one conversations with people who were afraid for me. They were afraid that I was going to become political and use, like, my background and my knowledge of Scripture to, like, further this gay agenda that I wasn't really, it was ambiguous about what that was, but there was like one-on-one conversations. But no, I don't feel like there was a scandal, that there was a lot of conflict. I felt like I did the right thing. I followed my heart, and I think whether or not people disagree with my choice, the way that I came out, the way that I did things, whether or not they disagree with that, I think they respected the fact that I was being honest, mm-hmm. and that I took care and thought to not be in leadership and have like this hypocrisy.
Mm. That's really, I mean, it's extremely fascinating. And, you know, it's quickly, I want to say that I believe that growth, there's a large opportunity for growth in conflict a lot of times. So I don't encourage people to avoid conflict. I don't encourage you to seek it out either, but if a situation occurs, I don't encourage you to flee from conflict, because a lot of times that is where a lot of growth opportunities occur.
Right.
And, okay, so back on track here. Now, the church believes that a gay man chooses to be gay. It's not by birth.
Right. It's like the nature versus nurture conversation. And when you say the church...
Mm-hmm.
There's like, the church is the body of Christ, right? It's the bride of Christ. It's the universal body of believers. I think, like, there's a difference between, you know, different sects of Christianity, and then Westernized Christianity is very much different than Orthodox Christianity, and there's a lot of in-betweens. And so there are several Western sects of Christianity and denominations who... don't have an issue with same gender relationships, and there's, you know, different takes, and so it gets into like doctrine and how we interpret the scriptures and whatnot. And so, but mainstream evangelical churches are in a position right now where they're deciding how they're going to handle this in American culture, this social issue. And, you know, I've known for a long time that I was gay, and I knew that there would be some type of rejection or conflict when I did come out. So I was trying to just not bring a reproach upon that organization, but I knew by coming out, I was jumping into conflict.
Yeah.
You know, I knew that people were not going to be as accepting of it, of me, and I made a conscious decision to face that head on and develop and tell my truth. So, but my experience while I was in the church was pretty phenomenal. And I used to use this analogy that it was kind of like a lifeboat. The church to me served as a lifeboat. I felt like I was drowning. I felt like, you know, I was kind of dead in the water. And I got pulled into this lifeboat, and it's like in the movie The Titanic, when there's like dead, cold people in the boat mm-hmm. and stuff like that, and stinky, rotten flesh, and there's like, I might have got scraped as they pulled me out of the water, and I might have got bumped and bruised in my experience with the church, but it was still a life-saving experience. And so, even though I felt kind of like an outcast in some ways, or that I didn't fully belong because I didn't feel like I could remain in the church, mm-hmm. and then be an out gay man, and then also I didn't feel like I was going to be like the Apostle Paul and have a life of singleness, and I wanted companionship, and I wanted to find a mate that I could live a quiet, peaceable life with. And you know, I found that, and I've taken a very conservative approach. Like, I believe in monogamy, I believe in committed married relationships, I believe in a very traditional Judeo-Christian relationship, but I was able to, you know, apply that to my life and my relationship as a gay man.
Well, that's awesome. I first of all want to say I appreciate you for sharing your story with us.
Oh, thank you.
And, you know, I'm just trying to put myself in your situation, which is nearly impossible. Right. And it seems like it was either to have people accept you for who you were not, this maybe fake thing that you were putting on, it wasn't your true self, or and be in the jail of your own mind, you know, interacting on a daily basis, but really knowing deep down inside that that's not actually who you are, and there's a large part of you that nobody knows, which seems very torturous to me.
Well, I guess I want to say that it wasn't a large part of me. I think it's one of the smallest pieces of the pie. And I think that on all the other levels, I was myself. And I gave them me. I gave mm-hmm. them my true self. And so, but just having that one thing,
mm-hmm.
just that one thing that I felt like I couldn't be truthful about, caused a lot of turmoil. And it caused a lot of conflict in my relationships as friends. And yeah. I felt, I went inward a lot.
Mm. Yeah, I could only imagine.
Yeah,
and you know, my stance, people are probably kind of curious to know, like, what our stances on this whole thing. And let me speak for myself, and my brothers will probably agree that I don't really know how I feel about it. You know, I definitely, sitting here with Don and experiencing him over the last few days, like, absolutely nothing wrong with Don at all. And not only is there nothing wrong, but there's all that is great about Don. He's like an amazing person, and there's absolutely no reason that I can't be as good of friends, if not better friends with him, than a man who's attracted to women. So I don't know where I stand. You know, I was raised in a Southern Baptist household and was taught all my life that homosexuality is wrong and that it's your choice. And at this point in my life, I just don't feel that I'm ready to take a stance on that yet. And I certainly wasn't ready when I was a kid.
Yeah.
I just had no idea. But one thing I do know that does feel wrong to me is to condemn homosexuality, the, you know, what is it, a race? Or not...
What, a people group?
A people group.
It's a group of people.
You know, I'm not trying to be very politically correct here, because I feel like a lot of times when people are politically correct, that that just causes confusion, and there's a lack of empathy because we're trying to live up to someone else's standards. And so let's just put a political correctness to the side here for a second.
Right, that's fine.
I just want to say that in my experience with the people group of gay people... I've had nothing but great experiences. And actually, I think you guys cater to our type of personality more so than your average heterosexual.
Oh, that's interesting. So, like, you're like raw, organic, healthy lifestyle.
Yeah, like the gay community just seems much more conscious of living life. They've definitely faced more adversity, I would feel like, in which means they've had much more opportunities to develop as humans.
So, I guess I'd like to share a couple things too. So that you said about being raised in a Southern Baptist. My parents were Baptist, mm-hmm. and you know, I was able to come out to my parents before both of them. Oh, well, my dad, not my mom. My mom had passed away before I was able to speak to her about it. But I do want to say a couple things. So there are people in the gay community who live a lifestyle that I disagree with.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't believe in, for myself, that, and even if I'm not going to condemn someone who has a polyamorous relationship, or if they have multiple partners, like, I have my own beliefs about that, and so I don't want to really speak to that. But there are some very unhealthy behaviors in the gay community. There are people who put themselves at risk, and I think a lot of that stems from being repressed and, like, not being able to be themselves for so long that it becomes deviant behavior. So when we start talking about drunken orgies and stuff like that, mm-hmm. the biblical references of things, those types of lifestyle, like, I would like to be clear and like that I completely want to disassociate myself from those lifestyles. Not out of internal homophobia because I'm ashamed to be gay, yeah. but because that's not me. And if you're not in relationship with me and you don't have like a daily interaction and you don't establish my character and what my lifestyle is, there's a lot of like this transfer of your lifestyle is bad or I disagree with your lifestyle. But it makes me always say, but you don't know what my lifestyle is because you don't spend time with me. So if we stay distant,
right.
and like likewise, I can't always just judge, oh, well, Christians are all like this.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So even though I stepped down from the church and I spent a season of just not wanting to be around zealous Christians, people that were really like forward with their faith and very outspoken with it, I wanted to also not do like an overcorrection to where I became isolated and then I was like on an island and I didn't have a variance of perspectives and faiths speaking into my life, because I think that's like the fabric of God's family is having this diverse group of people that surround you. So yeah, I mean, I know that there's a lot that I just unloaded.
This is a big topic, you know, this is a huge topic. And we're not going to get it all right in this one video, you know?
Right.
There's probably going to be a lot of things that are left unsaid, a lot of rocks unturned, but that's okay, you know? I think a lot of what this video is about maybe may go without verbal communication, just to see, you know, me and Don here speaking in the context of love about this topic says a lot itself.
Yeah, and I would want to acknowledge, like, that it's been nice to come here and it not be an issue. You know, to spend time with the RawBrahs mm-hmm. and to focus on what we agree on and what but not avoiding anything that we might disagree upon either. But we're not letting anything drive a wedge between us or anything like that. So I think if we operate in love, it kind of prevails. It kind of just diffuses all the other things.
Yeah, you know, if it was something that came between us, it would be me acting. It naturally, I feel pulled towards Don because we have so much in common and I have so much to learn from him and probably vice versa. So the only reason that there would be any kind of separation between us is because of my ideals that have been placed in my head by society or, you know, growing up. But, you know, sitting here right here with him now, I'm just thankful that he's here and I'm glad I get to spend the time that I do with him.
That's awesome.
Let me ask you a few questions.
Go for it.
Out of my own curiosity.
I love questions.
So, what do you think about, well, you said it earlier, like, are people have the choice to be gay, or do you think they're born with gay?
I think it might be a combination.
Okay.
I think that we are all predisposed in certain things. I think as children, we develop personalities in a, like a people-pleasing, like we want to please our parents.
Mm-hmm.
And so we make choices that we think are pleasing to our parents. So there's a variance of family backgrounds. You know, there's a lot of dysfunction, there's abuse. There's things that if a child is abused, they could think that, oh, this is pleasing to the adult that I'm trying to, and so I think that there are a lot of probably predisposed heterosexual people who've struggled with their sexuality because of abuse. I think that's pretty clear. I think mm-hmm. we've all, and you know, that was an initial assumption, like, was I abused? Was yeah. I, you know, was I sexually abused? Why is this happening? Why am I this way or that way? And you know, like, there's so many like variances or like shades of gray in, or maybe that's not the best term. I like what Ted Haggard said. He's like, there's complexities.
Okay.
When he was talking about his situation when he was in the news and the public, you know, during his interview, he's just talking about there are people are complex, and God's complex, and you know, the spirit world is very dynamic. It's very there's a lot of facets to God, and so if we're created in His image, there's a lot of facets to us too. You're not just a brother. You're not just a raw bra. You're a raw son,
mm-hmm.
and you're a raw friend. And one day you'll be a raw husband. You know, like, so there's multifaceted aspects to all of us. So, even if someone said that they chose to be gay, like, oh, I'm choosing to be gay, in a way, like, I chose to accept what I think I was predisposed. And I chose to accept that I do believe that God isn't making mistakes, and that if He created me this way, I definitely know what it feels like to be abstinent and to not, and to try to pray it away and to fast and to go through types of ex-gay therapy. I know what that feels like. I know to try to choose not to be, and that was not natural, and that caused sickness and stress, and I was not at ease. So it was causing a level of dis-ease that I felt like if this continues, I'm going to hurt myself more. I felt like I was already hurting myself in choices that I was making. I started to, you know, drink alcohol at a level that was probably not appropriate for anyone. And I got depressed. And I wanted to hurt myself. And so it was at that point where I felt like, okay, so I need to learn to love myself and to make choices that are going to benefit me, and that if I'm going to serve my purpose in the earth, I need to be strong and build myself up so I can have something to offer out of strength instead of just offering weakness.
Mm. Okay. It's on. Okay, cool. Now, do you have any family history of homosexuality?
Not that I know of. So I don't have, like, the biggest family in general.
Right.
I'm unaware of any aunts, uncles, or cousins in my family who are gay.
What would you say is the most challenging part in your journey, or along your journey, about being a gay Christian?
Well, I think the hardest part was getting people to understand that the whole time I was in church, I was gay.
Right.
They just didn't know it.
Uh-huh.
So it was a huge smack in the face when they knew it and they were like, we don't want to have anything to do with you.
Mm. Mm.
And it was like, but I'm the same person. It's just this one aspect, this one slice of my whole being, this one portion.
Yeah.
And it's not my whole identifier. Like, I think if people who have walked away from relationship with me, if they see this video, I think they'll recognize, like, well, that's the same guy I went to college with. That's
yeah.
the same guy I went on a missions trip with. That's the same guy that prayed for that kid in Guatemala with me when we were just really on fire for God, and we were just really wanting that kid to be healed. And that kid was asking for prayer out of, like, this intense faith, you know? And so I think that if people you know, would take the time to say, to be open to stay in relationship with people who identify as gay, they'll learn that we're not full of the devil. You know, I didn't give my mind over to reprobation. Like, God didn't turn me over to Satan to buffet my flesh until I come back to him. Like, I think it's been nothing but a constant wooing of love and sending people into my path and feeling the Holy Spirit talk to me and initiate times of prayer and worship and intimacy with him. So it's interesting, you know, it's an interesting experience. But like, that was the hardest part, was just having people who I thought knew my core, like my the essence of who I am and my character. And like, I knew a lot of people for 10+ years, and they just walked away from the relationship. And, you know, granted, I didn't come out the best way for some of them. I projected my own rejection. I didn't even give them a chance to ask questions like we're sitting down here, because I had so much expectation of, this is not going to be accepted, this isn't going to go well. Yeah. So I'm going to just do myself the favor and step back. And I kind of, and so after several conversations of like, I can't walk down this path with you, and like, I'm no longer your friend, and other things that weren't so kind,
yeah,
and not so loving. Like, after that happened, I was like, okay, I only want to sign up for so many verbal lashings.
Yeah.
So then I just removed myself. So, but that doesn't make it okay to just isolate myself. So in that way, I wasn't necessarily fair to them. Mm-hmm. If I really wanted to fight for those relationships, I could have brought myself to those too. So like, I don't want to just put it all on them, and right. I'm not a victim, mm-hmm. you know? So I have to be responsible for my actions. And I acknowledge that I definitely push people away.
Mm. You know, would you agree that the Bible speaks against homosexuality?
I would not agree with that.
You would not agree with that?
No, I think that the Bible is clear about deviant sexual behavior.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't necessarily mean same-sex relationships.
Okay. This is where we're going to get all the copy and pasting of scriptures on the YouTube comments.
So, I think that that's great. Copy and pasting scripture is fine. However, like, you know, we can't pick and choose, right? Mm-hmm. And so they probably feel like I'm picking and choosing and whatnot. So, like, I spent $60,000 on my education,
mm-hmm.
and a lot of years of my life so that I could know what the scripture said mm-hmm. for myself. Okay. So lay people can quote scripture all they want, but if you don't know how to break down a passage and exegete the scripture in its original language and do word for word and thought for thought, cultural historical analysis like a scholarly, mm-hmm. you know, so that's a lot of pastors, you know, and there are a lot of ministers that maybe have like a Bible college degree that's not super thorough and scholarly. And I mean, the holy text is pretty intense, and if you just approach it casually, there's a lot of room for error. And so like, I mean, we definitely don't have enough time to break down, like, so there's, if you read Genesis, there's this thing called the law of first mentions. And it's like an axiom in theology that like, if it, the first time it's mentioned in the Bible, that becomes like the law. Like, so then we approach it. So like, when people hear the story of Sodom and Gomorrah, that is their law of first mentions. This is where God sets his foot down and this is it.
Mm-hmm.
But if you break down that passage of scripture in its original language and not a homophobic King James version, and if you break down like how many people have gone through the Bible and commissioned their version of scripture, and there's so many political things that happen, like, if you know, there's all these politics between like priestly writings in the Old Testament and prophetic writings. So the prophet literature is very political because the priests were very political. And so there's politics involved. And so we can break down the scriptures and we can get into it. And back to your question about nature versus nurture, like in that passage, it deals with, is it natural for me to lay down with a man? And the principle in the Sodom and Gomorrah, the way that I believe, this is the way that, this is a, was a huge reconciliation for me.
Okay.
Is that the principle there is not that those men wanted to sleep with other men. It's that those men wanted people who it was not in their nature to change who they were to be like them. And I think that that is the cardinal sin. I think that Christ came and he wants us to be us. He wants us to be your unique expression of him. And if anyone tries to get you to be someone that you're not,
yeah,
that's against your nature.
Right.
And now we're stepping into kind of like a witchcraft area of manipulation. Like, I want you to be like this.
Mm-hmm.
And there's fear, because if it's not natural for me and someone's asking me to do something, it's just not in my nature to do that. And so I'm going to say, no, thank you. But when we try to force people and we become inhospitable, and that was the thing, is like, this was about hospitality. This was about the angels coming and Lot trying to be hospitable, and then these guys are trying to get them to go against their nature. And so that behavior plus the lascivious behavior that they were participating in the streets, I don't agree with. But the principle of same-sex relationships is not, I don't feel like that's condemned if you really break down that passage. And I think that that's what, like, the most quoted scripture passage, right? So, you know, just learning that and then talking to really respective theologians in different denominations.
Mm-hmm.
And if you, you know, there's a side of the Methodist church that when they break down that passage, they'll tell you the same thing. And Episcopalians are pretty progressive in their theology concerning, so there's different sects, but when you start getting into the charismatic Pentecostal evangelical denominations, that's where the biggest conflict is. So, like, can you be a gay Christian? There's tons of us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's tons of people who have a Judeo-Christian worldview, an approach to life, an approach to their relationships, and I think that they're flourishing, and I think that God's blessing them, and that they're living, like, this life. And it's sad that people are so fixated on someone like myself, who, if they view me as, like, I'm being prospered, and I'm growing in my career path and my life path, and they are like, you know, I hear things like, that's the devil. The devil's prospering you, and it's a trick.
Yeah. It's interesting, you know, just to, you know, I did this interview with really no preparation, and I never really debated with anybody, especially a gay person, whether it was right or wrong, and now I'm doing it, not really debating, but in front of an audience. So this is where I kind of stand. I feel like I need to express myself here.
Yeah, do it.
I am not the most... I have not studied the Bible very much, which I'm slightly self-conscious about, but I don't know if it's rightfully so, you know? My relationship with God is very personal, as I feel it should be, and it should be different for every person. And to try to say that, you know, if you're going to be a Christian, then you should have studied the Bible and you should have read this many passages, I think is trying to put people in a box. My relationship with God is very open. And
it's more faith based than logic based.
Yeah,
right?
it's much more logic based. I mean, it's much less logic based and more faith based, and just going through a daily practice of talking to God and sharing with him almost everything that happens to me.
With your heart, right?
Yeah.
It's a very heart-based relationship.
With my heart. And that's... I imagine that people want to see me take a stand or pick sides or say there's certain things that just don't come naturally for me to say, because, you know, aside from what the scripture may or may not say, you know, I'm sitting here with Don, and he's a freaking, like... He's just like me, you know, in so many ways. And how can I ever... It just doesn't come natural for me to be like... It's just not natural.
And likewise, it's not natural for me to just condemn all Christians because I'm gay. And
yeah.
I know a lot of gay people who, if you say you're a Christian, they're like, stay away. I don't want to have anything to do with you. You know? And the same way that maybe an agnostic or an atheist doesn't want to have to do with anyone that has a faith.
I mean
that's not natural for me. So like I want to just say, like, it's not okay for me to judge you by your faith or how you practice your relationship with God.
Yeah. I don't know, maybe one day I will. Maybe one day I will. But right now, it's just, it's not where I'm at to condemn gays for just, you know, for that certain thing. Like you said, you know, I don't agree with a lot of the what some of the gay community does, but at the same time, I don't agree with a lot of the heterosexual community does either.
Right?
You know?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of just behavior that is not appealing to us, you know?
So yeah, I don't know, you know. I don't know, you know. That's quite a statement.
I don't know.
You know?
You know that I don't know everything, which is great. We don't know everything. No, I don't know everything either, but I definitely was diligent in my study. And there is some really great scriptures, like, His grace is sufficient for me. And sometimes when people, they want to go and quote all this scripture, I think about, you know, scriptures in 1 Timothy, and I'm like, you know, 1 John, and I'm like, God is love. And that's, like, the end of the story. God is love. And I experience Him in many expressions of love, and I do think His grace is sufficient for me. And whether I'm living, if I'm a sinner saved by grace, or, you know, it's like, when it comes down to it, I always just ask people, like, is His grace sufficient for me or not? And I choose to believe that it is.
Yeah. I was just going to ask you before you seemed to answer it. Who is God to you? Or, you know, which denomination, if you will, do you fall most in line with? You know, you just said that God is love, and I definitely agree with you. I think that Jesus was the ultimate example of love and true altruism. What He demonstrated, what true altruism is, and to love unconditionally. And anytime we find ourselves facing adversity, or whether it be a confrontation with someone, or, you know, your neighbor, it's just like, just like that famous saying, what would Jesus do? You know,
right.
And He always chose love. And that, to me, is motivation on how to live my life.
Yeah, I mean, well, like, you know, His ultimate sacrifice is like, it's the epitome of unconditional love, that He would lay Himself down for His friends. Like, is like the biggest expression of that. And I think that, you know, I do believe in, like, trying to acquire the mind of Christ. And as we endeavor to have Christ-mindedness in our practice, in our daily life, and in approach, that we start finding all these manifestations of love, and we start to experience all these different versions of the Godhead. And, you know, I know all the names of God, and I don't know all of the names of God. I know all the names of God that I know. And they all take on a different meaning, you know? And there's, like, references, like there's a name in Hebrew, it's El Shaddai, and it means the many-breasted one. And it's like this image of how do I have an image of God with breasts, you know, and multiple, like, but it speaks to, like, maybe a cow having udders, and it's sustenance, and it's a provision.
Mm.
And it's that He can provide, like, the milk and nurturing for us. And so there's all these different aspects of Him. But I think we get caught up in language.
Yeah.
And when we can silence, like, language and get in a posture of openness to the Holy Spirit, and allow, you know, a spiritual exchange to take place, I think that's where, like, the richness is of relationship, because then, you know, I'm not defined by semantics anymore, and we get hung up on word meaning so much. And, like, I was taught that, you know, the definition of healthy, effective communication is based on the definition of terms. So when you say the word God, mm-hmm. some people hear, they have this picture. Or
right.
If you say, I'm a Christian, mm-hmm. I remember riding in an airplane, and I was reading a book, and someone said, "Are you a Christian?" And I was just like, "Well, what's your definition of a Christian?"
Right.
Before I answer that question, what's your definition of a Christian, so I can make sure that we're on the same page.
Right.
And so, like, there's so much room, and we get caught up on when we don't agree on word choice.
Right.
So
agreed.
Sometimes I find myself censoring saying Christ or Jesus or the Holy Spirit or any of my Judeo-Christian names that I have for God.
Mm-hmm.
But when I hear a Buddhist or a Hindu or a New Age person talk about their spiritual relationship, I try to find Christ-mindedness
mm-hmm.
in there. I try to apply a non-judgmental and I try to just apply my experience and my relationship with how I view God, mm-hmm. the way that I see things. And I don't, try not to force my versions or my words on anyone. I just try to listen and find how can I love this person? And how can I learn from them even if I disagree with them?
Right.
So, yeah.
I saw a Facebook image online the other day. It was like a great lighthouse doesn't go around the island trying to shine its light on different boats. You know, or trying to show its light to different... It just stays in one place, and it shines its light, and the boats come.
Yeah. And they find their way.
And they find their way.
Yeah. That's a great one.
Yeah.
I think that you guys are doing that. I think that you don't try to shove your faith in anyone's face. Mm-hmm. I think you're just living... You guys are bright lights, and you bring people into your orbit because there's light. And, you know, if you're the light of the world and people are drawn to that and they want to, like, pull from that and you guys are really, you beam back at people. You reflect God's love back to, like, you know, there's a saying, like, the moon has no light of its own. It's just a reflection of the sun.
Mm.
You know, if we can be like the moon, we don't really have any light of our own. We're just a reflection of that light that has been illuminated in our hearts.
Mm. Well, thanks. That's awesome.
Yeah.
I'm glad that's what you've experienced in us. I mean.
Yeah, you guys are great. How are we doing?
Good. Yeah. And I think a product of the way we live our lives is based on our experience with people. The most influential people in our lives have definitely not been the ones that have come to us with well-structured, theories on life, and have tried to push them onto us. It hasn't been the crafty individuals with their, you know, again with their theories on the world, or whatever. It's just been the people who we've watched, and said, wow, they have a way of peace about them. They do things. I don't know. It's been something more that we felt, and not so much things that we've seen or read, or heard, that has been most influential to us. So maybe that's why we've chosen to express ourselves the way we have, and as have you, I think, you know.
Yeah, no, it's I am so grateful. Honestly, I've had some amazing people pour into my life, and I've had amazing mentors, and whether or not I'm in a relationship with them today because of my sexuality, I don't discount it, and I remain grateful for all of those influences and all that love that was poured into me. There was a lot invested in me. Like, I didn't just show up like this, you know? It's like, there are a lot of people that poured into my life. And we were talking earlier about planting seeds and watering it, and sometimes people get to come and harvest it, you know? So, like, if there's any goodness that comes from this conversation, it's a result of all those people that planted and watered.
True. True. Well, I mean, you know, honestly, I feel like this video could go on forever, but I feel like if we're going to come to a conclusion, this could be it for now.
Yeah.
And maybe we can do another, we'll see how the responses in this video. I'm sure it's going to be off the wall, but.
I'm sure too. And it's okay. I hold space for people to be just on fire with their faith. And like, I hold space for that. And I don't expect everyone to sanction me or sanction you, or there's going to be disagreements. But I think what our goal is just to show, like, can can, is there such thing as gay Christians? I think there is. And can Christians be friendly and have close, intimate relationships on a friendship level, non-sexual, with homosexuals and lesbians and other people of the queer community? I think so. And I think that, you know, even if you wanted to share your faith with a person that is of a different sexual disposition, friendship's a great place to start.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Can a Christian be gay? My suggestion would be to spend some time with Don. Spend some time with someone like Don or another awesome gay individual and open yourself to them, share your experience with each other, and you decide.
Yeah, I think that's awesome. Especially if you have someone in your family. I would start with your family. If you think someone might be gay in your family, or they're struggling and there's conflict because of it, if you come from a Christian home and there's, you know, fear, there's a lot of fear, in especially about young people, you know. I can only imagine being a young person who might identify as gay and being in a hostile environment. And we see a lot of teen suicides and things like that because of these compressed, pressurized situations. So I think that, you know, if you just reach out and you humble yourself and you let go of what you think is right for a moment and you just try to shine love and light on that person, you could really probably save a life. You could alter your perspective. You could gain a really good friend. You could... There's endless possibilities with that. And you could open yourself up to a little bit of conflict. And it's not going to be always easy, but no. I think it's worth it. No. I do. I think it's worth it, and I would encourage fellowship, no matter what.
Right on, man. All right.
Team Mango.
Look forward to hearing back from you.
Yeah, it's going to be fun.
In the name of love.
Love.
All right.
Bye.